you went over there, you said you had approximately 2 weeks of training. So has that amount of time increased with people who are going over there, or? Because I'm thinking 2 weeks, and you go over, and you're right in the middle of all of that.
Every unit have like a pass check that they call. So for 5 years out, they know when specific units are going to deploy. So there's a certain cycle that the military has that you go into if you're going to deploy, and you're at step one, and there's a certain process that allows you to be trained up. So when you hit the ground in Kuwait, when you're there for 2 weeks, which is standard throughout, it's just kind of a tune-up. And just an update on any of the tactics that are being used in the area that you're going in. Once you get to where you're going, you have, they're called right seat, left seat, right. So you sit with the unit that's there, and you sit, in the passenger seat. When you're out on patrol, they take the lead, you learn, and then you flip-flop. And then that's a handover, too. So eventually, then you take over. So that 2 weeks is just a tune-up, but it's standard.
When you were in Baghdad in that area, did you have any idea who you could trust and who you couldn't trust in terms of the people?
I remember the first time that we went on the streets of Baghdad at night. You see people walk around and you don't know who's gonna. I remember the ride from Baghdad International Airport to Camp Liberty. It was a safe zone at the time. I didn't know that. So I thought we were on the streets, and I was nervous as could be. I didn't know who was who. But to answer your question, we didn't. And we had to build that rapport with the town, the unit that we took over from. They didn't have much of a presence in the town, so the villagers didn't trust Americans because of that unit. So our unit had to build that rapport with them. Once we were able to build that rapport, you can kind of figure out who you can trust, but you could never really trust anybody. So it's I guess to answer your question, no, we don't.
Were there any women deployed with you?
Yes. The unit I was in was a mechanized infantry unit, so combat arms units don't have women. At that time they didn't have women. So we didn't have any women in our unit, but the forward support companies did. But we would utilize women in our patrols because men couldn't search women there. It was just culturally wasn't accepted. So we would bring women on our patrols to help search. So they were part of some of our missions. So what's more, you said talk about the boredom?
Is boredom of being over there so long, is that just as bad as it was or is that combat?
You said your grandfather was in World War II?
He was in the Korean War.
So they had him a lot rougher than we did. When we went over there, when we were in Camp Liberty, we were taken care of. We had a gym. At Camp Liberty, we had a gym. We had a store. There was a Taco Bell. But we were able to read. We were able to order stuff off of Amazon and get books. We had DVD players. We had TVs in our rooms if we wanted to. We had air conditioning. If we all had air conditioning. So I don't think order really affected us. We had cell phones. More just finding ways to keep yourself mentally fit and not go crazy with looking at a calendar was tough. And before we went, I had a group of guys that we'd work out. So when I was on Camp Liberty, we worked out twice a day. When I was out at an outpost and work out once a day. If not, I'd rather, if not, I took a nap, you know, so you keep yourself busy. I don't know if that answers your question or not, but it did not have it as bad as they did at all. What's that?
Mark, you thought about being angry at your immediate commanders about pushing you guys into a fight you didn't want to go into, which you thought was obviously over the day or what kind of a feeling was it to have that sort of anger at, I'm sure you didn't all the time, but I'm just saying to have that kind of anger and then to have that constant feeling of suspicion and not continuing knowing who to trust in the area. Is that a very difficult thing to deal with?
Yeah, I commanded at the time and looking back on it, he was outstanding battalion commander. When he was making those decisions at the time, he was getting a lot of pushback from soldiers, you know, from officers, because they didn't, I think we understood the big picture, but, I mean, our guys were seeing their friends get killed, and they were seeing that picture, so they could really care less about the big picture, or winning over hearts and minds, or making sure that these people had a safe life with their friends, or you know, they didn't care. So it was tough, especially when, you know, I didn't agree with some of his decisions either. So it's tough to kind of motivate your guys to do the right thing when you yourself don't believe in his decisions. I mean, there was anger, and it's really just at times going day by day and reassuring these guys. Deep down, you didn't know if they would be okay. You know, they had guys knock on my door. They also had stuff going on at home. You know, they can really care less if these Iraqis could, you know, go to the bank and not worry about being killed. You know, so that was tough. And that stayed throughout. The more violent it got, the tougher it got. And you couldn't really blame those guys.
After, now that you're out of the Army and everything's done, would you say that you now agree or disagree with the war that was happening?
It's one of those questions that I never really had an answer to it, because if I did have an answer, I feel it would have influenced how I acted with my guys. So I supported what we were there to do. I supported whatever it was we had to do to keep our guys safe. But I can't give you a yes or no on that.
When vets come home, what sort of things do they have to do or that they try to do to assimilate themselves back into normal functioning society? Things should they go through, or do they kind of need to go through?
So when I came back, when you come back, you have like a 90-day period where you really don't do anything. When you come back, everybody wants to go on leave. Everybody has their 30 days of leave. They want to do, they kind of want to check the box on what they have to do and go home. They put you through, you're forced to stay in the States. You're forced to stay where you're stationed at for at least a week when you come back. And you gotta go through this checklist of things, you know, get a physical, see the mental health provider, go to the dentist, go to the eye doctor, and do all these things. And when you've been gone for 15 months, you're not gonna tell somebody, I got a toothache or, you know, I'm not really doing too well because it's going to keep you from going home. So they put those things in place. So that's what was in place when we got back. As I was transitioning out there, getting more into the weeds with how to address every soldier as opposed to making the general thing. So they had mental health providers at the company at the lowest level, and they had every soldier, you know, meet with this mental health provider to address any issues. Everything was confidential. So that's what they do. They offer free counseling down there. They're military family life counselors, but you're not forced to go. So they have things in place, but most of the guys just check the box and most usually they can go on.
Does it work? Because I know some vets still suffer post-traumatic stress and they have difficulty assimilating. Do you think that that 90 days helps? Some people can't ever really adjust that.
Well, you have your 90 days. Most come back. You have decent money saved up. You're making tax-free money when you're over there. They have money saved up. That 90 days is going home, and then you come back and you have 60 days. Well, really nothing's going on. So they're partying and spending money, and they're not really focused on it. And getting assimilated back in society. After that 90-day period is up, like I was telling Mr. Sullivan, you're on that pass chart. And most of the guys on that pass chart, when we came back that time, within a year, we were already scheduled to go back. That unit was scheduled to go back. So why assimilate when you're going to go back anyways?
You said you're in the reserve now.
Yes.
Could you possibly go overseas if something happened?
We're not scheduled to for like 4 or 5 years.
Okay.
So,
that's good. That's a good thing.
How strong is the IUD present?
What's that? I can't hear it.
How strong is the IUD present?
IEDs. What was the IEDs like when you were out in the field? Could you tell them what IEDs are?
Improvised explosive device, so it's a bomb. They were, during a few months period, they were pretty intense. They were at major intersections that we would travel down because it was a town that we were in. So if you can imagine, like driving around South Buffalo, the main roads, the Abbott Road, Tift, and like South Park, McKinley, is when you have tanks and Humvees driving down the road, you can't maneuver well down side streets. So they knew where we were going. They would plan them there. They would anticipate our movements. They would look. They would watch us. Al-Qaeda was making, they had a certain way of making bombs. And they used like homemade explosives. And they would bury them underground, or they would have trip wires, or remote detonation, car bombs. So it was, they were powerful, they knew what they were doing, and they would just target us. Because it was just like driving around the town like this, so it was kind of predictable on where we were sometimes. Especially when you have a tank coming, you can hear that for a few miles away.
What you saw big pop up there for the
over there?
Yeah.
I think it was bigger than we knew. What was going on. I had, at that time, it was like when one of my guys was on pills because he, I forget what it was, because he got hurt or he was having some mental health issues, so they just gave him some pills. I know they have a steroid problem over there as well. Drinking, I didn't see too much drinking. I know one of the companies, their first sergeant, they got busted for drinking. One of the other battalions, one of their captains was drinking with the soldiers and some of the Iraqis too, and he got caught. So it was going on over there. When we got back, it was definitely heavy drinking. A lot of heavy drinking when we get back. Sometimes, marijuana use, we get kicked out, heavy drinking. DWIs were common, motor vehicle accidents were common. They used to have a ticker outside of the gate, and the ticker would say, how many days since the last fatal motor vehicle accident. And when we reached 30 days, we'd get a day off. So it tells you, it tells you how prevalent that was there. So it's definitely, drinking is normalized. Heavy drinking too when you do that is normalized, and it's prevalent, especially with like combat arms. It's there. It's definitely there.
Did you originally apply for the ROTC just to help pay for college?
Yeah, I didn't know what I was getting into. It was the best decision I've made by far.
What happened if you got it?
So you sign up, and your junior year you have the choice of whether or not to fully commit or to back out of it. So I fully committed, and they paid for everything. So even at that time, I didn't know the extent of what I was getting into.
What do you have to do for it, though?
What do you have to do for it?
What do you do when you're in the ROTC?
You have certain military classes you have to go through. 1 week a month to do military specific training. And it's all organized just like a regular battalion is in the military. There's rank structure, there's like physical training 3 to 5 days a week that you have to do. And you follow the same standards as if you were on like active duty or the National Guard. So they just really, they train you up and make you as ready as they can really for when you go on active duty. Okay.
So one more. One more question for Mark. One more.
Is your order on?
I can get you guys afterwards. I'll be here. I got time.
Did you ever collaborate with any of the other armed forces while you were there?
Yeah, we did. We had a Navy electronic warfare officer that we worked with some of the vehicles, some of the devices and jammers that our vehicles had. We worked with them pretty extensively. I worked with the Air Force. Part of my job was to work with the Air Force and Army's attack aviation to coordinate air support and air coverage and attack aviation. So those three right there were huge in helping us